their willingness to be supported in our effort for the conference here at World for Jesus International. We appreciate that, me and our team here today. How many were blessed yesterday during the conference? Praise the Lord. We thank God for the opportunity to be here with you once again. It's always a pleasure and a privilege for us. We look so forward to these moments. We treasure these moments to be with all of you here, and we're so thankful that God has opened the door in the Philippines, and the people of God here are so receptive. And of course, the pastors that have come from different parts of the country, different parts of the area to be here with us, we want to thank all of you for the tremendous effort you made to be here. Some came 12 and 13 hours to get here, and we certainly do appreciate that. And we appreciate our ladies out there in the hall that have been registering. Let's give them a God bless and forget them. Amen. And we appreciate all each person that does his part for God. You know, the Lord sees all that, and he knows all the things that people do, even behind the scenes. And we have a television program back home. We have our own channel called The Promise Channel out of the university. And when we began to do our television taping, and I'm a host, I do the hosting on the program, and I didn't realize all the work and the effort that went on behind the scenes. I'm just the guy in the front of the camera, but I didn't realize all the things that go on behind the camera, and it was really something to see. So we appreciate each one that has a part. How many know when we put all the parts together, we have the body of Christ? Amen. Let's give him praise for that this morning. Amen. Well, again, I have the wonderful privilege of introducing our guest speakers. Each one is unique. I'm sure that you've noticed that every speaker that we have has their own style of ministry. Have you noticed that? God has a variety of people, and he has a variety of giftings that makes it so interesting. Each one is a bit different, but the Word of God and the intent and the content of the heart are exactly the same. Amen. And so I appreciate all of our speakers that have made an effort to be here to be part of the conference with us. Adele and I have always believed that it's a team effort. It's not one person alone, but it's a team. Even our coordinator, Pastor Ray Manatis, we appreciate his hard work in coordinating and making the proper connections. But how many know God has all the connections? Amen? Praise the Lord. Somebody told me a long time ago when we were endeavoring to begin our international ministry years back, and we were very new at this, very novice in that area, but we had a willing heart. We had a desire to do more for God, reach out to other nations of the world besides our country. And someone said to me, well, you know, Brother Mike, if you're going to attempt to be an international evangelist and speaker, you know, you're going to have a person of great influence. I said, brother, we have a person of great influence. It's the Lord Jesus Christ. Come on. He's the one that has the greatest influence of all. He's the one that put all this together. Amen. So we learned years ago that to trust in him, and he would make all the things come together. He would bring all the people, fitting all the parts together to make a whole. So today, again, it's my privilege to present Sister Avelina Kuwaye. You want to get that straight. And she has a ministry there in Carson, California, called Faith in Christ South Bay. She also has other ministries that she's involved with internationally. She's spoken in different countries of the world as well. We're so happy that she's part of our team, a great teacher and exhorter of the word. Each one has a different gifting. Hers is exhortation and an area of teaching and speaking. And God gives her great revelation as she speaks and as she ministers. I appreciate her being part of not only our team from America, but I appreciate her being a part of our team for our lives personally. So anyway, without any further ado, let's give a warm welcome to Dr. Avelina Villanueva Kuwaye. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How was your day? Your night?
Good.
Great?
Amen.
Anak, natulog kayo?
Amen.
Di ba kayo namahay? Anyway, I love you're enjoying the today's conference.
Amen.
Amen. Our church has celebrated its 25th anniversary, last year, 2016, 25th anniversary. And our text was on the glory of the latter house is greater than the former house. You believe that?
Amen.
The glory of the latter house is greater than the former house. In the Lord, there is no demotion. In the Lord, it's just promotion. Promotion and promotion, walang demotion. So, praise the Lord. I'm just happy to be a part. What a beautiful praise and worship we had this morning.
Amen.
Palakpakan natin ang Panginoon. The teaching this morning, if I'm going to entitle it, I can put a lot of titles. It can be the role of teaching in the kingdom of God, or the call to preach, and or we are called to preach. But I think I'll take the second one, that each and every one of us are called to preach, to teach. I'm sorry, it's not to preach, but to teach. So to teach. Yesterday, you still remember the message, the lessons yesterday?
Yes.
The three groups of spiritual gifts. And if you count it, at least 21 gifts, you can see 21 gifts, those are three verses of scriptures na yun. So this morning, why is it very important that the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ would go back to teaching? Bakit teaching? You know, when Jesus Christ was preaching, one of his names was, anong teacher?
Rabbi.
Very good. Rabbi. Kahit saan siya magtungo, he was called Rabbi. Rabbi. You notice that? He was looked at as a very good teacher. Everybody say teacher.
Teacher.
So you may say, but Pastor Belen, I thought maraming spiritual gifts, and we see the word teach in two groups of scriptures. One in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. Isn't it? You remember that? Okay. And then there is another gift, which is the motivational gift, which is found in Romans chapter 12, verse 7. Doon sa Ephesians 4:11, it is called ministry gifts. It is a gift of the Holy Spirit to the church. So if these are being fulfilled in the church, blessings overflow. Apostles, prophets, evangelists, teachers, pastors, teachers. In some commentaries, apat lang, four only. The pastors, teachers are considered as one. Ibang commentary. Sa iba, it's fivefold ministries. So, sineparate yung teacher at saka yung pastor. Because yung isa, four lang ang considered nila na gifts. Because it is considered that if you're a pastor, you are a teacher. You are a teacher of the word. And that's your job. That's one of your jobs. Ang pastor, ano pang jobs natin as a pastor? We protect the sheep. We teach them. We instruct them. We guide them. Amen? So, pinoprotektahan natin siya, sila. So, if you're a pastor, you're also called to teach. Now, a pastor is a teacher, but not vice versa. Not because you are a teacher that you are a
pastor.
Ah, magaling akong magturo, ano hindi akong magturo, therefore ako ang dapat na pastor. Ah, inansik mo na yung pastor. Kasi magaling kang magturo. It doesn't mean. Because sometimes, yung pastor, yun ang calling ng Lord sa kanya. He can teach, But sometimes, ako sa church namin, mayroong mas magaling na teacher sa akin. And I am not threatened. Amen?
Amen.
I am not threatened if I have good teachers in the church. Because I am confident of what God has told me to. Kaya minsan sabihin ko, eh sino ba pastor? Ako pastor eh. Isn't it? Kinol ako. I may not be good in many areas, and I am not very good in many areas. Pero tinawag ako. Kaya, I'm serious with what God has told me to. Amen? So, today, kinaklarify ko yon as we start in the teaching this morning because everybody is called to teach. Everybody, okay. Tap the shoulder of the person beside you and say, you are called to teach. Okay. Iba yun sa pastor, ano? Clear na yun. A pastor is called to teach, but a teacher is not called as to be a pastor. Okay, clear tayo dun. Bakit ko sinabi, why did I say that everybody is called to teach? Open your Bibles with me to Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 to 20. The Great Commission. Everybody say the Great Commission. Do you know that, the Great Commission?
Yes.
One time young people ask me, Pastor, what is the Great Commission? Sabi ko, you don't even know what the Great Commission is. The Great Commission, yung inutos ng Diyos sa atin, sa bawat isa sa atin. And, let's see, if it will be shown on the monitor. Nasaan na? Sometimes I don't know where to look kasi nakakasilaw, ano? Kaya pagpapasayaya. There, no, Matthew 28, Great Commission. The Great Commission. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, everybody, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. Many Christians, they say that the Great Commission, pinuput up, inaano lang nila, kinakat nila into go and preach the word. No. The Great Commission is from Matthew 28 hanggang 20. All authority in heaven and on earth. Yung authority, it's different from power. Satan has the power, but he does not have the authority. Jesus Christ has the power and the authority. And the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ has the power and the authority. Amen? By virtue of our faith on the Lord. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, I go and make disciples of all nations. Ang kukulin daw natin to make disciples.
Yes.
Mag-disipulo tayo. How many of you can say you are a good disciple maker?
Amen.
Ha? Kung hindi nyo pa naisip yun, I'm putting it into your mind. You have to be a mentor to someone. You have to be a discipler to someone. So sabi doon, go and make disciples of all nations. This is the Great Commission. Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. To baptize means na convert mo sila because of your preaching and teaching. Some people, some Christians, they want to build up church using other Christians from another church. Ano yun? Nag-fishing doon sa aquarium ng iba. Huh? You go get your fish in the ocean. So here in Matthew, when it was said, you therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them, it means that we start with conversion. You preach the gospel, you share the gospel to them, they get converted, you baptize them in the Spirit, and then you don't end up there. You make disciples of them. Amen? And in making disciples, it's very important, andun na yung letter B. And teaching them to obey everything. My lesson this morning is about teaching. That's why I said you are called to teach. Yung sa Romans 12, if you have the gift of teaching, teach. Diba sabing ganon? Iba yon doon sa Ephesians chapter 4. That's different from Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. The gift of a teacher in the church. The other one is for the believer to teach. How do you know? As we will still go on. Di sabi dito, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. That are your teacher. How do we know? Because everybody's going to be a teacher, not with a church educational program. Hindi yung may BSc education ka, or AB, or anuman yun, whatever, hindi yun. But you are called to teach, to communicate Christ's gospel as a parent, as a neighbor, as a friend, involving teaching principles. Some of you, we were not able to is not enough for all the things that we want to teach to you. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
We did not even mention about the marketplace ministry.
Yes, that's right. Mm?
But the marketplace ministry, you are called in that area, and we can say that you teach them to obey everything, not in a class, not in a curriculum, not with an outline, but you teach them as a parent, you teach them as an employer, you teach them as a friend, you teach them as a whatever. Ano? So, ang ibig sabihin is, yung sa marketplace mo, kung saan ka man, you have the responsibility to teach one another that they will obey the word of the Lord. Amen? So, the Great Commission is go make disciples and teach them to observe. Now, another verse that we want to see, Matthew 9:35. Matthew 9:35. Are you there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Ready? Wala pa. Your Bible. Sige. Matthew 9:35. Ready? Go. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness among the people. Minsan may lalapit sa akin. Pastor, can you pray for me for healing? So, before I pray for healing, sometimes I speak words to them. You know, Psalms 103, Proverbs 4:20-22, Matthew 9:35, Isaiah 53, I quote scriptures on healing. Eh, ayaw. Nasabihin nila, can you just pray? They don't want to listen to the word. They just want you to pray and for them to receive the healing. I want you to see here in Matthew chapter 9:35 the process that Jesus did. Jesus went through all the towns and villages teaching in their synagogues. Every Saturday, he would go into the synagogue, he would go into the temple, and he would preach, and he would read from the scriptures, and he would share. He would teach the word, preaching the good news. So there's teaching, there's preaching the good news, and then there is
healing.
Eh, maraming tao, that's a shortcut, gusto lang nila healing. Amen ba? They don't like to sit down and absorb first the teaching. They want miracles right away. And sometimes they go, listen, they do not receive the miracle. And even if they receive the miracle, the next week, balik uli sa kanila yung sickness and disease. Why? Because it was not founded on the Word of God. Amen? It was just the emotions of the moment. And it should go, we as pastors and preachers and teachers, we have the word of God to teach to them, to preach the gospel to them, and then to heal. And to heal. Amen?
Yes,
amen. So, palakpakan natin ang Lord. Amen. As we avail ourselves to be used by God, God is more concerned with our life rather than our work. Okay. As we are serving the Lord, anong concern ng Lord? What is more important to God? What He is doing with us rather than what we can do for Him. Amen? Kung anong ginagawa niya sa buhay natin is after that. It's not what you can do for God. He does not need anything. But what He wants and what He is after is what He can do through your life. Now, in teaching, God wants to mold us and teach us first. Everybody say, first.
First.
Even before we share it to others. Ano muna tayo? We become the partakers first.
Yes.
Then when we receive it, then we are able to give it.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
You that are teaching and you that are pastoring and you that will become future teachers and you that are called to teach, it's important that you first receive from God and then whatever you receive, then you share it. Now there are two extremes here, two possible extremes. Some people, they place emphasis on intellectual capacity and the ability of the teacher. They're very good intellectually. They know how to make outlines. 1, 2, A, B, little one, little A. You know that? Huh? Yung mga ganun-ganun, outline. No? As you make your preaching, as you make your sermon, ganyan-ganyan. So, many times, some intellectual capacity and then the ability to preach. So, they copy the movement of the preacher. Yung favorite, ano nila, preacher. When to put emphasis. When to speak loud. When to soften their voice. Mga ganun-ganun. So, intellectual capacity and ability of the teacher. Doon sila nagko-concentrate. The other way naman, it stresses on spiritual qualities. As long as I'm a Christian, as long as I do this, I'm ganito-ganito, I don't have to study. You don't have to say amen, you just say ouch. Everybody say ouch. So some people will say, I don't have to study, why do I have to attend the Wednesday Bible study? Anyway, I receive books and magazines and I can just teach it. Yung bang ganyan, ano? Yung spiritual naman, spiritual. The biblical way is both ways. The biblical way is, what is important is both the ability and spirituality. Okay? The ability, you learn. You know? Hindi ako talaga maskom. I just flow in the Holy Spirit. But, I have to learn, see myself, where I can improve. Amen?
Amen.
It doesn't mean na hindi ka na mag-i-improve.
Yes.
You want to be effective for the Lord both ways. You train yourself, you go through the training, you pay the price, everything. Amen?
Amen.
And at the same time, you're spiritual, you pray, you depend on the Holy Spirit, you're led by the Spirit of God, you know how to worship, you know how to read the scriptures, find the scriptures where they are, memorize the scriptures. Amen? Both growing spiritually and even in the intellectual side or ability. Amen?
Amen.
Sige, palakpakan muli natin ang Panginoon. The reason why I ask you to pumalakpak, so that you will be awake. Okay? Okay? Because I say, teaching is actually, preaching is very good because you make everybody, you know, excited. Ang teaching is medyo, ano na sabi ko? One, Roman numeral 1, Roman numeral 2, 3, letter big A, big B, big C, little number 1, number 2, little A, ganun-ganun. So, anyway, our job then is to make disciples, teaching the converts to observe all things that God has commanded. So, who is called to teach? Everyone, raise up the hand of those who are called to teach. Amen. You are called in the marketplace to teach other people. Amen. If you work in the bank, you are called to teach your co-employee. If you're a mother, you are called to teach your children. You are called to teach. Everyone is called to teach. Now, however, there are qualities needed to be an effective teacher. And this also would work not only in the area of the teaching ministry, but also as an ordinary Christian, by the way. I'll give you five qualities. Number one, dedication. You must have dedication. You must be dedicated. You possess genuine commitment to the Lord. If you say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Kailangan committed ka. Pastor, I'm sorry, I cannot make it today. I'll be absent. Kailangan, if you are called to do something, first, it is very important. You have a commitment to the Lord. And to the task of teaching. I said that you must be good steward in his teaching ministry. We are called to be a teacher in the area of the Ephesians 4, 11 calling as a teacher. You start reading your Bible from Genesis to Revelation. You start having a library. I have an extra room when we were new in the state. I have this room. And everyone that came to my house was laughing, smiling, because it's like a meron akong mga bookshelf. Then I have the Holy Spirit, all the books that I have, Holy Spirit. Leadership, I have the books. Marriage, youth, children, and it's like a library, it's in my house. It's not in the library, it's in my house. And then I have to have the concordance. I have to have different study Bibles, you know. Because I call this a teacher, and I'm serious with it. Amen? Yes. Devotion, dedication. See to it that whatever you do, you're fulfilling the purpose of God in your life. Amen. Number two qualities, teachableness. Everybody say teachableness. Ano ba yung teachableness? Intelligence is desirable, but equally important is teachableness. Teachable. How many of you can say you're teachable? Wow! Teachable! Pag sinabi, like this, o paano ka? You're teachable, you're open. You're open to be led by the Spirit of God. How about those who say, lahat ng sabihin mo, if you say left, they'll go to the right. If you say black, they'll go white. You're laging nakakontra, laging, ha? Are you understanding what I'm trying to say? A teachable person, tinitingnan-tingnan niya mo, of course he prays. He is led by the Spirit of God. But sometimes, di pala nila alam. Alam na nila, mag-negate ka agad sila. They will start negating. And not teachable. So, teachableness. Flexible to the Spirit of God. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. Grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So grow in grace. Are we growing? Yeah. Growing in grace. Or you've been a Christian for 30 years and you're still the same, high maintenance ka pa rin. In our church, and I say, you know, darating, you know, I go, nako, high maintenance to? Pag hindi na shake hands, hindi na ngitian, absent. And unless you call them up, oh, I miss you in the church yesterday. Oh, pastor is not calling me. You know, high maintenance. No, but grow in grace and in, oh, you're getting some words. Yeah, you can take the yung words na yan. Yeah, high maintenance. Okay. Grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The third one. Okay. So, dedication, teachableness, sacrifice. Yesterday, Dr. Belen mentioned about holiness. You know, if you serve the Lord, there are perils in leadership. Perils. Everybody say perils. Ang perils, yung danger zone, crucial to the ministry. Some people start correctly, anointed, and at the end of their Christian life, backsliding, yung ganon, mess up. Family na mess up, ganun. Now, it takes sacrifices to live a life pleasing to the Lord. Amen? Are you willing to sacrifice? Are you willing to die to your own self? Are you willing to die to your own desire? And these are crucials because yung perils of leadership are loss of money, no? Loss of money. When I was a new Christian, I have met mga young people. I'm going to be a pastor. Oh, why? Because I cannot find a job. Ooh. Ouch, yun. I love that. Honest. They go, oh, so you're going to be a pastor because you cannot find a job. So where are you going to plant a church? Where are you going to plant a church? Sa Alabang. Sa Magallanes Village. Mm. Ayaw sa Nueva Vizcaya. Gusto lang the city. You understand? Perils of leadership, lust of money. Walang pera dyan eh, in the city. Love gifts, malaki. Mm. Tapos, ano pa? Oh, ano to eh? Wealthy to. Kaya follow up. Disciple. Kaya gawin kong disciple. You know, these are the perils of leadership. Sacrifice that kailangan natin, okay? I-give up natin. The last four. Money. Ano pa? Pride of life. Pride. These are the dangers in the ministry. No? The perils. Love of power. You know, I found out, pagka nakahawa ka ng power, it feels so good. Huh? It feels so good to be calling the shots. It feels so good when you say things and people, lalo na Filipinos, we have that colonial mentality, no? Yung mga nasa, I remember when I was growing up, I was a graduate of St. Paul's. Eh, graduate ako ng St. Paul's. Ang tingin namin sa pare, oh, talaga namang, yung idol namin yung mga pare. Yung mga madre, yung idol namin. The nuns and the priests. We Filipinos, we have a little outbalance in, no? We respect them, but it should always be out of God's spirit and love from our hearts. So, the parents of leadership are the loss of money, love of power, opposite sex. Huh? Tahimik ngayon. Gender. The ethics in counseling is, if you're a man, counsel only a man. If you're a woman, counsel a woman. If you're a woman to counsel a man, see to it that your husband is there, or you're somewhere in a public place, or you know, you have put up some hurdles so that you will not commit or fall into sin. Are you following me this morning? And as a pastor, if you're in the leadership, you know, if you're a man pastor, no, women are so, ano, so they love men in the macho men, you know, they love macho men, and they look up to you, and if you take advantage of that, you fall. So a lot of pastors and in the ministries fall because they are not conscious of this value. Amen? So the qualities, marami akong mga, I have a lot of ano ha? Taking down notes?
Yes.
Okay, good. So opposite sex, pride, you know, that's one of them. So that we have number three now, qualities. Dedication, teachableness, sacrifice. Number four, knowledge. Open your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1. Knowledge. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1. Therefore, I'll read to you Amplified Version. Let us go on and get past the elementary stage in the teachings and doctrine of Christ, advancing steadily toward the completeness and perfection that belong to spiritual maturity. Let us not again be laying the foundation of repentance and abandonment of dead works and of the faith by which you turn to God, with teachings about purifying, the laying on of hands, the resurrection from the dead, and eternal judgment and punishment. Certainly, we should increase in knowledge. When I was a new Christian, I goal in my life to finish reading one book a month. So I will try to finish one book a month. That was my goal. It's very important, we learned in this conference, that you must have a mission, you must have a vision. So my goal then was to be able to read a book, at least one book a month. It says in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1, therefore, let us leave the elementary teachings about Christ. So it's not anymore John 3:16, okay? I asked people, give me a verse. John 3:16. I said, you better graduate from John 3:16. Huh? You can give me another verse. I don't accept anymore. That's elementary. Therefore, let us leave the elementary teachings about Christ and go on to maturity. And you can only reach maturity as you grow in the knowledge about God. Amen? And that's the quality. One of the qualities that is needed if you're going to be a teacher, a pastor, a worker in the Lord. You need to be growing up in your knowledge. Last night, one of the questions was a new revelation. Huh? Or your new revelation mo and the knowledge that you have was panahon pa ni Mahoma. No? 10 years ago, 20 years ago, we should be growing up in the knowledge of God. Amen?
Yes.
So the next one, number five is maturity. Maturity, forever learning about the Christian faith. Forever learning. Read, study the teachings of Paul. Paul said, not that I have already attained it, but I press on toward the mark. Everybody say, press on.
Press on.
Okay, so we know these are the qualities if you're going to be a worker, a teacher, a pastor, and a leader in the Lord. You must have these qualities. You must have dedication. You must have ano pa?
Teachableness.
What's your favorite here? Teachableness. Sacrifice. You have to sacrifice. Okay. Sacrifice, it's very important. Carry the cross. Unless you carry the cross and follow me, Jesus said, you are not worthy of being my disciple. We need to carry the cross. The cross is not your problems. The cross is not your husband or your spouse. The cross is not your children. The cross are the things that you have to carry to follow the Lord. What is the cross? You wake up early in the morning and you pray. What is the cross? That you die to your own desire. That you die to your own self. If you know that your relationship with this person will not help you in your spiritual growth, the cross is you take that person out of your life and hang around people who can build up your faith. That is the cross, the things that you carry to be able to follow the Lord. Unless you are willing to carry the cross, you are not worthy of being my disciple. So, maturity. Now, the purpose of Christian teaching. Why are we teaching? It's not for our own personal satisfaction. Why are we teaching? Do we understand our teaching purposes? If you're a teacher, you made the outline. And even if you're a public school teacher, you have all those kind of things. The lesson plan, you have the lesson plan. And you have a goal. What is my goal? When I preach, when I teach, my goal is for everyone to receive the word of the Lord and that they will be changed from glory to glory.
Amen.
I don't want you to get out of this conference the same.
That's right. Amen.
I want to impart something to you.
Amen.
Not emotionally, but I want to impart something to you from the scriptures that you can read, you can take when you go back to your own churches and you apply it in your lives.
Amen.
Sometimes I meet people. We just came from London and Brussels, Belgium. And, you know, the young people, the pastors there, the supervisors now of Europe, several nations there, they were our young people when we were starting to go to London in 1984.
Yes.
They were a group of our young people. I think 12 of them became pastors of different churches.
Yes, amen.
And then they tell me, Pastor Belen, Ate Belen, they call me Ate Belen. Ate Belen, I still have the notebook. Nagre-retreat kami palagi. I go twice a year in England. Nagre-retreat kami. They would take down notes. How many have taken down notes this morning? Yeah, don't rely on your memory because, you know, your memory. If you ask me later, ano nga ba tinitch ko? My senior moment. but you know that, Ate Belen, I still have your notebook. I still have that illustration. You know, 25 years ago, 30 years ago, the illustration that I still remember that I gave. You know, I have some of those illustrations. I have no time to give it to you today, but you know. But it means that they have received it, kept it, put it in their notebook, in their heart, in their mind, and live it.
Yes.
That's right.
What is the goal of what's the purpose of Christian teaching? The purpose of Christian teaching is that we examine our purpose. This is where our motivation comes in. That they may lives may be changed.
That's right.
That they will hear the word of God. And that they will do things according to the instruction of the Holy Spirit. Amen?
Amen.
Hebrews 5:12, it says, for though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God. You've been a Christian for 50 years, 30 years, and you should be the one teaching, and up to now, you still need somebody to teach you. Ahaya. Huh? By this time, you ought to be teachers, but you still need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God. My question will be, grow up. Let the person beside you grow up.
Grow up.
Amen. So every adult Christian has the responsibility to mature sufficiently to be able to serve God as an effective teacher. The parents, when they look at their children, what makes them happy? When they see their children doing, walking correctly, righteously in the Lord. How about yung mga parents, secular parents, they see their little children know how to curse? No? Naka-smile pa sila, tuwa. O, marunong lang magmura ang anak ko. little children, they can, and they can curse. And then it sounds funny, but that's not our purpose. Our purpose in teaching is for lives to be changed. And mentoring, you mentor them, and then they will mentor. You raise them up the way that they should go. When they get married and they have their own family, you see them doing the same way that they were raised up correctly and righteously. Amen?
Yeah.
It will be very, very satisfactory sa inyong mga puso to do that. Amen? So, it is our responsibility to mature sufficiently. Uy, matatapos na ako. Now, we sing sa life ni Jesus. Sabi natin, si Jesus, Matthew 28 also, go and preach the gospel, baptizing them. So from conversion, you turn into discipleship. So the process is conversion, discipleship, leadership training, sending out. Okay? Conversion, discipleship, leadership, sending out. So some Christians, they want a shortcut. They get converted today, tomorrow, they want to be a pastor or an evangelist, and they don't want to go through the process. So, si Jesus, nakita natin, he took his disciples from all of this. Where do we find it? You open your Bibles with me to Mark chapter 1. Mark chapter 1 from verse 16 to 39. Did you find it? Mark chapter 1 from verse 16 to 39. And this is what we can, we learn that we are called to teach, and that it is our job to teach other people, whether it's a marketplace or it's in the ministry. We have a job to do, and then we become mentor to them. Amen?
Amen.
Mentor. What's a mentor? Kaya nga, disciple is a student. If there is a rabbi, if there is a teacher Jesus, there should be a student. There should be a Bible student. There's a rabbi, there's a teacher, there's a student. So are you a good student of the Bible? Are you studying the Bible? So here's Jesus, Mark chapter 1 from verse 16. And passing along the shore of the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon Peter and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net in the sea, for they were fishermen. There's five steps. 5 steps that Jesus did his process of making disciples. And this is also a part of the Great Commission. Teaching them to become disciples. So he found them. Passing along the shore of the Sea of Galilee, he saw. Everybody say, saw. So he went. He went to them. He went to them. He went to the Sea of Galilee. I went to Israel. And, I went to the Sea of Galilee. And I better not start that because it will be a long story. Anyway, but Jesus went to them where they were, in their sin, in their business, where they were, and then Jesus changed their lives. Amen? Dale Osborne said, you go where the sinners are. But Pastor, I will just pray, Lord, send the people in my church. Bring growth, Lord. Lord, send people to my family. I cannot witness to them. We want a shortcut. Eh, yung pala, Jesus wants to use you in your family. Amen?
Amen.
So the first step of Jesus here in making his disciples, calling his disciples, he went to them where they were, and then they were where they were doing their own ordinary chores, and where they were, Jesus went where they were to change their lives. Step number two, he called them. Let's continue reading. And Jesus said to them, verse 17, come after me and be my disciples, and I will make you to become fishers of men. So the next step of Jesus, he called them. The real minister of Jesus is not a person who called himself. There's two things. The other one, it's either the other person went or the other person is called. Last year I spoke on ethics, and some people said, oh, I'm very good now, I'm a good preacher, I'm a good teacher, I will start a church, I will leave my church, and I will go to this place and I will start a new ministry here. They went on their own. Amen? But the real process of Jesus, and it should be like this, you are sent. You have a covering, you are under accountability and responsibility to a higher organization. Amen? What the himik? It's okay pag dinanamnam nyo. Okay? It's okay if you're meditating on it. So some people go, some people win instead of sent. It has to be sent out. Amen?
Yes.
It has to be sent out. You did not go because, oh, I don't like my pastor now. Oh, I don't like, you know, in the U.S., they don't like President Trump. They protest. Sometimes I am tempted to say, you know what, he is not the president, whether we like it or not. He's now the president. Let's learn. Amen? And if you don't want, you can go and go back to your country. Amen? But to stay there and destabilize and go against, minsan eh, few times some people came up to me, Pastor Belen. My calling from the Lord, God called me to check the pastor.
No.
I said, where is that in the Bible? Give me the verse where it says, the calling is to check the pastor. I gave you the spiritual gifts yesterday, the callings of the Lord. Did you see it there?
No.
No? So you don't even call to your pastor and say, Pastor, my calling is to check you. Honest, talaga. Mga twice siguro, people told me. They would call me and they said, I am here, God brought me to this church because God wants me to check on you. I said, no, God did not tell me to do. God did not tell me about that. One of them, she already went home to be with the Lord. No, but she was very good, you know, older lady. But she's very, you know, she said, Pastor Belen, you're my 11th pastor.
Oh.
Pang 11 na ako. And then, you're the only pastor that gives me gifts on Christmas. And Monday morning, she would pick up the phone, she would call me. Monday morning at 6 o'clock, she would call me, Pastor, I don't want you to be laughing. Pastors are not supposed to laugh.
Oh.
I said, sorry, I love to laugh. And real laugh. I used to, I would go, Eh nanay, sabi ko gano'n, gusto kong tatawa eh, saka malakas na tawa. Kasi nakaka-relax yun eh. And if you have no, if you're not no important thing to call me about, sabi ko gano'n, can I ask you, don't call me from 6 o'clock in the morning. If you have a question, call me 10 o'clock in the morning. And up to 10 o'clock at night. But don't call me 11 o'clock at night, okay? Some people, they think that God told them to check the passport. It's not in the gifting, okay? So Jesus said, come after me and be my disciples, and I will make you to become fishers of men. So the next step is called. So Jesus went to them, found them, called them to himself. Everybody say himself.
Yes.
Amen. Pag nagme-mentor tayo, we are not calling people to ourselves. We are calling people to follow the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. The third one, he taught them. He taught them. Nasaan tayo? 18. And at once they left their nets and yielded up. It's an amplified one. All claimed to them, followed him, joining him as disciples and siding with his party. Verse 19. He went on a little farther and saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who were in their boat, putting their nets in order. And immediately he called out to them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and went up after him and followed him. Okay, the next step, you found them, then you called them, and you taught them. This year, God was leading me. You know, in the past, I've been a pastor for 25 years. And I have, throughout the years, some people, there was even a time, 60 people left the church. There was a time, the first, you know, in the States, Filipinos are always, big families. And Filipinos are, what do you call that? Yung kamasama tayo.
Clannish. Clannish.
Clannish. And if one of them get mad at you, the whole family gets mad at you. Experience you yon? Huh? And I said, what did I do to them? I always ask the question, what did I do to them? Huh? Nothing. They just want to go inside with their relatives. Because the relative was offended. And they made up stories. So there was some time, yung ganyan, ano. So throughout the years, ayan, nawala to rin ang istorya ko. but I would teach always. I told you, I'm called to teach, and I love to teach. This is my passion. So I would teach. And sometimes I said, Lord, I don't want to do anything anymore. No? Ayoko na. Bahala na kayo. No? Gusto nyo, you want another pastor, you go. Wherever you want to go, free for all. But then, if you're the gift of God to you, you follow it. You can, even though you say things like that, deep in your heart, the gift is there. And you will always go back to the gift. So I started again. I started teaching again. I would teach again. I would train again. And this year, the Lord told me, in the past, you teach everybody. You've been teaching everybody. What I want you to do now, kaya nga yung the next lesson, how to hear the voice of God, you know? What I want you to do now, you concentrate only on those that will. Itingnan mo sila. You look at them and then you call them a little closer, and you don't spend your time to everybody. You only disciple or mentor few people. Amen? So for a year, I was not doing what I used to do. I would preach in the past, I would preach 5 times a week. I would be all over the place. But this last year, the Lord says, concentrate only to a few people na who will be loyal and faithful to the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
So, yun ang tinuturoan ko ngayon. Taught. The next step is teaching. So, found them, called them, teach them, taught them. 3 years, they were at his side. 3 years, they were listening the teaching of Jesus. 3 years, observing Jesus and his lifestyle for 3 years. Then after that, he showed them the ministry. That's number four. He showed them how to heal the sick. He showed them how to cast out devils. He showed them how to pray. And the disciples one day did not ask Jesus, teach us how to cast out devils. Did not ask Jesus, teach us how to heal the sick. Did not ask Jesus how to do this or how to do that. The disciples asked Jesus, teach us how to
pray.
Teach us how to pray. Because they saw, they observed that through the praying of Jesus, that the power and the authority of God flowed in the ministry of Jesus. And they said, teach us how to pray. They zero in on the real power, and that is through prayer. So the fourth step of Jesus is, after teaching, is show them the ministry. And then he told them that they would copy or duplicate the quality of the works of Jesus. Are you still here?
Yes.
The last one, the fifth one is, and then he sent them out. Amen?
Yes.
Kaya we have the Matthew 28, go and preach. But he sent them out. And when he sent them out, Jesus was in Luke chapter 24. I want us to see it. Luke chapter 24 from verse 49. And this is where I am ending today. Did you get already something?
Yes.
Then it's my time to stop it now. You know, sometimes as a pastor, we still want to speak. But once the point has been clarified and received, it's our job to stop. Amen?
Yes.
Amen ba?
Yes.
Pagpaulit-ulit ka na lang, boring down. It's not just. It has become the flesh. Because when God already spoke and have given what He needs to give, we end up now. Amen? We end up now. Or else, it's just our own idea and mind that is doing it. So, in the sending, the last portion, in verse 49 of Luke 24, and behold, I will send forth upon you what my Father has promised, but remain in the city, Jerusalem, until you are clothed with power from on high. So Jesus Christ rose from the grave, and for 40 days he was here on earth, finalizing everything, doing the right commission, the last commission, encouraging his disciples. He was about to go back to heaven. And then in this meeting, in Luke chapter 24, Jesus said, go back to Jerusalem, wait for the promise of the Father. Before you go out and take the world, you go back to Jerusalem, wait for the promise of the Father until you are endued with power from on high. And when you are endued with power from on high, then you go and preach the word and teach all nations. And they went back. Out of 500 people, 25% or 20%, between 20 to 25%, went back, obeyed the word of the Lord. And on that day, they were on the second floor, on the upper room, and the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke with tongues, and they were never the same again, and they took the world upside down for Jesus. But the final command of Jesus You go back to Jerusalem, wait for the promise of the Father. Do not go until you are endued with power from on high. God does not allow us to go unless we are filled with the Holy Spirit. Until you are endued with power from on high. If we skip that portion and we just go and we just go and want to do whatever we want to do, not being filled with the Spirit of God, then it's not according to the process of God. Amen?
Yes, amen.
So God, Jesus said, you go back to Jerusalem, you wait until you're endued with power from on high, and then you go.
Yes.
How important the anointing of the Lord is.
Amen.
God will not allow you to go unless you first receive the anointing.
Oh, amen.
And it comes by the baptism of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So I have 10 minutes. I have 10 minutes before I give the floor to our second speaker. But in 10 minutes' time, if you need the power of the Holy Spirit wherever you are, I will not ask you anymore to come down here. But when you're ready, you can receive the Holy Spirit right there. What is the power of the Holy Spirit? And we say, Holy Spirit, come and fill me. And then you speak in tongues. To be filled with the Spirit of God with the initial evidence of speaking in tongues. Pastor Belen, but I do not believe in speaking in tongues. It's from the devil. I have several people who told me that. I said, sorry. I believe. One time I was in a court, superior court. I had a young person who was picked up by the police. And the young person came, told me, talked to me in my house. I even drove for the young person. And he said, can you accompany me to the court, because he was pagkakamali niya, he made a mistake. Nag-joyride, he saw the car open and he drove the car, you know, and he drove the car and he was stopped by the police. And so he had a court case. So I went to the, so who are you? I'm the pastor. It's embarrassing because it's a sin, huh? But I'm the pastor, you know, he's just confused and being, how do you say that? Yung naano lang siya ng mga maling company, something like that. But he's really a good person and he's one of our young people from very start. But the family is a broken family and ganyan-ganyan. So the counselor said, the public defender, not the public defender, but the other side. He said, oh, so you're the pastor? I'm an atheist. Sorry, no? Americano. I'm an atheist. Oh, sabi ko naman ganun. I'm a believer. To me, I don't mind if you're an atheist. I'm a believer.
Yes.
Amen? Today, if you're ready to receive the Lord Jesus Christ, first, as Lord and Savior, then you're ready to be filled with the Spirit of God with the initial evidence of speaking in tongues. Why don't you try it? Amen? Why don't you receive that? Ako sabi mo, Lord, whatever your plan for me is, I want to receive it.
Amen.
I want to receive it.
Yeah.
Why will I limit the blessings or what I want to receive? Jesus told Peter one day, he was about to wash the feet of Jesus, and Peter said, oh no, I'm not going to wash your feet. Jesus said, Jesus was going to wash the feet of Peter. So Peter said, no, you're not going to wash my feet, Master. And then Jesus said, if I don't wash your feet, you have no part in me. And Peter said, then wash my whole body. How many of you can say, I want everything that God has in store for me?
Sure.
Amen?
Amen.
If God wants me to, this is my sacrifice, this is, I have to change my mindset, everything. I was raised up in a different way. But if this is the way for the power of God to be manifested in my life, I want it.
Amen.
I want it. Those who want it, you can stand right now.
Yes.
we can pray and then we can receive the infilling of the Holy Spirit with the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the initial evidence of tongues. Amen?
Amen.
Lahat tayo tumayo.
Amen.
And let us sing one song. Prepare your hearts to receive. Yung minutes lang ito, ha? So when the Holy Spirit comes, sabi ni Sister Belen kahapon, the anointing is there. You better tanggapin nyo. Don't come after because it's not, I tell them. While preaching and the Lord leads me to do that, then accept it and be in there. But don't wait until I'm outside after the service of pastor. Can you pray like this and like that? You did not pray and you did not come earlier. So we're going to sing a song.
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit, thou art welcome in this room.
Holy Spirit?
She was asking about it.
I know, but it's not
the only one.
Not
Holy Spirit. Put utterance in our tongue, bypass blessing our mind. Amen. Are you ready? Amen. Let's close our eyes. Let's raise up our hands. Say this prayer with me. Lord Jesus, I thank you for your word. I am sorry. I repent of all my sins. Sins in thoughts, in words, in deeds.
This morning,
I open my heart and my mind to you. Come and fill me. Make me anew. Fill me with your spirit. Fill me with your power. Fill me with your authority. I believe.
I receive.
I confess. And I speak. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now praise God. Praise Him in English. And then start to pray. Praise Him in tongues. Praise Him in tongues.
Those have been revived.